be groovy. Comment, like, share, subscribe.
When one thinks of British horror cinema, the iconic studio that invariably comes to mind is Hammer Film Productions. With its classic tales of gothic suspense and macabre horror, Hammer left an indelible mark on the world of horror cinema and monster movies. Let's take a look at Hammer's evolution during the 1970s.
Initiate sequence. Retrotron Entertainment presents
That 70s Nerd. Founded in 1934 by William Hines and James Carreras, Hammer Film Productions started as a small studio, producing a variety of low-budget films across different genres. It wasn't until the 1950s that the studio began to find its niche in horror. The shift towards horror was both a product of market demand and the recognition that there was a void in the industry from modern color horror films. The late 1950s saw Hammer reinventing classic monster tales. Two films in particular set the studio on its path to horror immortality: The Curse of Frankenstein, 1957, and Dracula, 1958. Both of which starred two of Hammer's most enduring stars, Peter Cushing and Christopher Lee. These films were characterized by their rich color, gothic period settings, and a more explicit approach to horror than was common for the time. These were not mere reproductions of black and white Universal classics. They were thoroughly reimagined interpretations of classic tales from literature, folklore, and horror fiction, stamped with Hammer's unique brand of storytelling and aesthetics. The success of these films proved that audiences were eager for fresh, vibrant takes on familiar monsters. Building on the momentum of the late 1950s, Hammer continued to produce a series of successful horror films throughout the 1960s. Titles like The Brides of Dracula, 1960, The Curse of the Werewolf, 1961, and The Mummy, 1959, showcased the studio's ability to craft atmospheric and compelling narratives. Hammer also expanded its horror repertoire beyond the traditional monsters. Psychological thrillers and paranormal tales such as The Nanny, 1965, starring Betty Davis, and The Plague of Zombies, 1966, were added to the mix. The studio was not without its challenges. As the 1960s progressed, Hammer faced competition from other studios, such as Roger Corman's lucrative and popular association with Vincent Price, and from changing audience tastes. By the end of the decade, there was a sense that the classic Hammer formula was becoming stale. The 1970s would present new challenges and opportunities for Hammer as it navigated a rapidly changing film industry. Hammer began to infuse their films with contemporary settings and more explicit content, both in terms of violence and sensuality. This was evident in movies like Countess Dracula, 1971, and Lust for a Vampire, 1971. The latter was part of the Karnstein trilogy, a series of films inspired by J. Sheridan LaFanu's novella Carmilla, and characterized by their more overt sexual themes. The Vampire Lovers, 1970, was another part of the Karnstein trilogy, and its erotic undertones signaled a shift in Hammer's approach to horror. Meanwhile, Dr. Jekyll and Sister Hyde, 1971, provided a gender-swapping twist on the classic Robert Louis Stevenson tale. Hands of the Ripper, 1971, integrated the historical figure of Jack the Ripper with fictional horror elements, providing a psychological exploration into the mind of a killer. Hammer's collaborations during this period were noteworthy. While Peter Cushing remained a stalwart asset to the studio, and Christopher Lee could always be talked into participating, usually over very vocal protest, newer actors like Ingrid Pitt became synonymous with Hammer's early 70s output, with her roles in The Vampire Lovers and Countess Dracula. She became one of the definitive scream queens of her time. While the studio's endeavors to modernize were commendable, they weren't universally successful. Some audiences felt that Hammer was straying too far from its roots, while others believed they weren't adapting quickly enough. The studio faced financial challenges, and a few of their films struggled at the box office. However, many of these films have gained cult status. They are appreciated for their ambitious attempts to blend classic Hammer elements with the sensibilities of 1970s cinema. The period between 1970 and 1975 was a time of significant transition for Hammer film. By the mid-70s, it was evident that Hammer's experiments in modernizing their brand were yielding mixed results. To address this, Hammer made attempts to return to its Gothic origins, but with contemporary spins. Films like The Legend of the Seven Golden Vampires, 1974, produced in conjunction with Shaw Brothers Productions, merged the classic Hammer vampire tales with the martial arts genre, capitalizing on the kung fu movie craze of the era. During these years, Hammer produced fewer films than in its heyday, but some are noteworthy. To the Devil a Daughter, 1976, starring Richard Widmark and Christopher Lee. This film was an attempt to enter the realm of satanic horror, a subgenre popularized by movies like The Exorcist and Rosemary's Baby. It was one of Hammer's final horror films and showcased the studio's effort to merge its old-world charm with contemporary horror themes. Captain Kronos, Vampire Hunter, 1974. This unique blend of swashbuckling action and vampire horror was Hammer's attempt to breathe new life into the vampire genre. Although not a major success upon release, it has since gained a cult following. By the late 70s, Hammer faced competition from multiple fronts. American horror films like Halloween and The Texas Chainsaw Massacre brought a new brand of visceral horror that was markedly different from Hammer's Gothic offerings. Additionally, British cinema was undergoing a transformation with the rise of gritty, realistic dramas and the punk movement influencing film culture. Financial struggles also became a significant concern. Hammer had always operated on modest budgets, but by the late 1970s, funding became increasingly scarce, and the studio found it challenging to compete in a rapidly evolving market. Ironically, it wasn't any single film, but a magazine that imprinted Hammer on the memories of young fans of the 1970s, the House of Hammer magazine. The mind behind the magazine was Des Skin, considered by some to be the British Stan Lee. As head of Marvel Comics operations in England in the 1970s, Skin reformatted existing titles, launched new ones, and acquired the BBC license for Doctor Who Weekly. For Hammer, Skin envisioned a publication that would celebrate horror and sci-fi in all their glory. One of the defining features of House of Hammer was its rich talent pool. Artists and contributors like Steve Moore, Brian Boland, David Lloyd, and John Bolton graced its graphically exciting pages. The iconic covers, usually painted by Brian Lewis, depicted the Hammer film being comic adapted within, making it a treat for collectors and fans alike. Des Skin introduced a mix of reviews, photos, features, and news encompassing films, television, comics, and more, a format that continues to influence online genre journalism. What set House of Hammer apart was its commitment to authentic comic adaptations. These were not mere retellings of Hammer movies, they were based on original scripts, often including scenes omitted from the final films. This approach meant readers were treated to versions of their favorite films that they couldn't see anywhere else. Despite its eventual demise, the impact of the House of Hammer magazine resonates in the horror and comic world even today. For fans of dark fantasy artwork, the magazine remains a collector's grail, and for those who lived through its publication era, like myself, it remains a fond trip down an enjoyably spooky cul-de-sac of memory lane. The impact made by Hammer films was solidified in the 1970s. For fans around the world, Hammer remains the first name in Gothic horror fantasy. Be sure to hit the bell for notifications so you never miss out on new videos and community posts.